Hello, and welcome to the Overly Animated Podcast, where we take animation seriously. We talk everything animation here, including Tuca and Bertie, which we'll be talking about today. I'm your host, Alex Bonilla, and today I'm joined by Sam Quattro.
Hello.
Michelle Anderer.
Hello.
And Ally Martin.
Hello.
Today we are discussing the full first season of Tuca and Bertie, which recently dropped on Netflix. We cover a lot of animation here, both on online streaming services and on television networks all over at overlyanimated.com, where you can find more about other stuff we've talked about. You can always subscribe to us on iTunes at overlyanimated.com/iTunes, on YouTube at youtube.com/overlyanimated, on Spotify, or wherever you listen to us. And we always appreciate any ratings or reviews you want to leave us. But yeah, today we are talking about Lisa Hannawalt's new show, Tuca and Bertie. This is, disclaimers right off the bat, this is a not safe for work podcast, since this deals with adult matter. Also, that we are going to talk about all of season one, probably right away, so spoilers abound. There's a lot to get into here. I think I've given the context that all you need to know, like, probably you've heard the show connected to BoJack Horseman due to some similarities in art style, and that is because Lisa Hannawalt was the production designer for BoJack Horseman and responsible for that show's look. But today we will be talking about how this show stands on its own. So let's go to Sam first. Now that we've watched the full season and we've had a weekend to let it settle in, what are your general thoughts on the show?
I think in the beginning I wasn't super duper into it. By the beginning I mean like the first half of the first episode. Mm-hmm. I was like, well, it's too zany for me, it's moving too fast. But then, you know, the gag started pulling in, and I really liked the normie life bullshit gag from that episode. And that just got me. Like, I was feeling it, I was into it. I liked how throughout the season they got sort of a interplay between the zany cartooniness of it and the more serious side of, you know, what it is to be a lady and the different things that we go through and stuff like that. So I think that it's this great sort of marriage of those things. I've also been seeing a lot of comparisons with it to like Broad City, which is like, okay, two female best friends, it's the same show, right? Like, okay, whatever, people. But no, I definitely think it's striking out on its own and really making a place for women and women characters in comedy.
Great, great, great. Michelle, your thoughts?
I really like this show. I'll echo Sam and the zaniness. It's a very zany show. It definitely has a lot of heart, and it's willing to tackle some more difficult topics, but like at its heart, like I appreciate it's like I can't remember the last time I saw a show that so much embraced just like the flexibility animation gives you as a medium in a way nothing else really kind of does. Because just like the intro, like a lot of times if I'm binging a show, I'll get to a point where I'm like, all right, I need to skip the intro. Like, time is money. But for this show, that's like unthinkable. Because one, the intro is like actually pretty short in comparison to a lot of shows. And two, it's like it encapsulates the zany nature of the whole show. And it's just like such a delight. Like when, like, okay, well, this is not safe for work, so it's fine. But like, yeah, when you see like the boobs bouncing on the like blue building in the first like 2 seconds of the show, it's like, okay, like this is the vibe. And like, I'm so here for this because like, when have I ever seen this before? So I'm a really big fan of this show. I also agree with Sam that the first couple episodes, like, I don't think it's quite hit its stride, but like, honestly, on repeat, I appreciated those episodes a lot more too, just in the context of the whole show. I think like when you're kind of figuring out the whole world, you're a little more lost. You're like, okay, like where are we going with all this? But by episode 4 or 5, I'd say like it really hits its stride, and from there it's just like, oh, it's so good. I wish there's more. I'm like a little sad that we had to binge at this point, because it's a very well-made show.
Okay. And Ally, what about you? What did you think about watching this?
Well, Sam and Michelle definitely covered the, it kind of, you know, is not slow, but sort of hard to get into until midway through the season. But I did enjoy it, even starting it. But it did kind of made me feel like it was too, not silly, but like the, I am a fan of the text popping out like it does. But at first it felt kind of not, like, kind of like it didn't belong. But I think at first because I was trying to compare it to BoJack, which was a mistake going in. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad that it is really, like, to me, it is like BoJack because it tackles, like, serious subjects, sort of. But the difference is this, like, isn't as depressing as BoJack. Like, it's nice to, like, it's easy to watch. BoJack will make you feel really, like, shitty a lot of the time, especially in the endings. But this show is more uplifting, even if, you know, the characters are going through, like, downward spirals or they're trying to get their shit together. It still makes you feel better in the end. And it's really, I mean, it's obviously very funny, but I don't know. It's not comparable to BoJack. I'd like people to stop doing that. Speaking as someone who went in doing that, it's not a good thing to do.
Right. And also, like, I've seen a lot of discussion online, like, of BoJack fans being like, well, will I like it if I like BoJack? And then, like, even people who are turned off by BoJack, it's like, well, I don't know if I want to try this. But, like, for sure, this is just its whole different entity sort of thing. The one thing that's comparable, as you mentioned, Ally, is, like, it does get into emotionally deep places, but in a different way than BoJack. So, like, even if that doesn't work for you, this potentially could, right?
Yeah, so, I think so.
Yeah, so and just my general thoughts, like, I also love this show a lot. There are definitely, like, certain emotional beats that that work with me pretty well. I think that the work that they do with the main characters Tuca and Bertie is the situation where, like, it can very easily devolve into, like, classic sitcom one-dimensionalness, but I think they do enough with both of those characters to, like, give both of them, like, moments that they need to feel relatable. Like, it's not a situation where it's like one is solely a comic relief character and then one is solely the serious. Like, they both have their own things. And so that definitely helps you to feel invested in both stories when they're together and when they're separate. And in general, just the whole vibe of the show is just so colorful, so, like, off the wall stuff. But then because it does the balance of the serious and the wacky, like, if it does it in a way that definitely feels, like, a lot comfier, I guess. Like, it soothes it when you get to those rough places. And I think it's fairly consistent. Like, you guys were saying, like, it takes, like, a couple of episodes. And I agree mostly that, like, by episode 3, I think, like, it already figures out, like, what kind of tone it's hitting. And, like, that's kind of where I, like, okay, this is a good show. And, like, it keeps getting that way for pretty much the entire season. So I would definitely recommend, if you're looking for a show to watch, Tuca and Bertie is great. And we will talk deeper about it. But there's a lot of places to start. I suppose we can begin talking a little closer about the main characters, since they're in the name, right? Tuca and Bertie. You got Bertie, just, like, you know, a normal looking bird with a sweater. Tuca is a flamboyant toucan. Tuca played by Tiffany Haddish, Bertie played by Ally Wong. They're very close friends, and they both have differing personalities. Before we get to them individually, I suppose we can talk a little bit about their chemistry, or just, like, how they act with each other. The friend stuff. Here, Sam, how did the two characters together work on you?
You know, in the beginning, like, before the show aired, I was like, is this gonna work? Is this, like, an odd couple situation where, like, Bertie is the really neat anal one and Tuca is, like, the wild child, ooh, blah 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 blah. It sort of had a little bit of that dynamic, but they definitely shine in their own ways, and I think their friendship is really nice and really wonderful. And, you know, they just support each other, and especially later on in the season when they kind of have, like, a break and they're really missing each other, and Tuca makes a sex cult and it's very zany and weird. I don't know, like, I definitely felt some sort of connection to, you know, Bertie has her boyfriend Speckle, right? That's his name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Speckle, sorry, Stephen. She has a boyfriend, Spackle, and I think that makes Tuca feel really kind of like third wheely. I mean, they say so as much, and they illustrate it with other similar couples. And yeah, that's like a feeling everybody can relate to. Like, you know, you have your best friend, but then your best friend has the boyfriend, and it's like, where are you in that? You know, are you still the closest person to them, or is that their boyfriend? So do you just like, can people have more than one important relationship, whether it be romantic or not, at the same time? I don't know. And that's what the show aims to solve, I guess.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Michelle, do you feel like adding on to that?
Yeah, I guess I was thinking a lot about, you know, which, if I had to choose, which was more relatable. I feel like Bertie's supposed to be more the every woman, but like I kept feeling way more invested in Tuca.
Me too.
Yeah. I wonder if that's like on purpose or not, but just like the stuff with Aunt Tallulah, and like even that little moment when she gets, and this is early on, first couple episodes, when she gets on the scary snail subway and she like sits down and she looks across, yes, and there's this woman that like is also a toucan. And, like, it's not clear if she's, like, homeless or something, but she definitely seems, like, kind of an old spinster. And just, like, moments like that, it just, it really humanizes Tuca. The fact that, like, she goes on a date with a guy that she really likes and she keeps messing it up every time he tries to do something genuinely sweet and romantic. Like, that just says so much about her character. And I don't know, I just, like, really hope she can be happy. I'm really glad she has Bertie, but, like, the third wheel thing, like Sam's saying, like, I don't know how sustainable that is long term, and Tuca just has my heart, so I want what's best for her.
Ally, any Tuca thoughts? Since I guess we're focusing on the Tuca side right now.
Well, I just want to say first, this cast is perfect. They portray everybody like the best, especially the main three. But especially with her family stuff, I think they get you to sympathize with her more because they focus on her family. Like Bertie, you know, she has, like Sam said, the boyfriend, and she has like a job, and meanwhile Tuca's like trying to get her life together, even though she's not really, she's kind of avoiding it. So I think, I mean, I definitely can relate to that, but I also can relate to Bertie with like the I forgot what episode it was in where she talks about her mom. I think it was her aunt's birthday episode, because she was talking about her siblings and how they grew up really poor, but her mom did everything, and then you find out how she died later, and you know, I think that at least gets you to sympathize more with her backstory. Like, we don't really know Bertie's, well, no, we do. they both have, like, trauma. Ooh,
but like, I honestly don't remember like much about Bertie's family at all.
That's the thing, her family isn't really mentioned, at least like her parents aren't mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, I love both of them to death. I think I can relate to both of them in a lot of ways, so that definitely makes it easier. I can also relate to Speckle because, you know, who can't?
we will Speckle. Get to Speckle, don't you worry. I'll go to you first once you get to Speckle. But I'll say that, like, Tuca, it's very genius by the show that in the first two episodes, like, she's set up as, you know, normal comic relief character. Like, she's the one doing the wacky stuff and, like, being full of energy and stuff. So, like, when you get to episode three and, like, she's the one who's, like, having, like, tough emotional inner turmoil, like, that feels great that, like, we're getting into that pretty quickly once you have, like, the setup of, like, what she is on the outside. And just that the fact that she is getting sober, like, that's a whole detail that's, like, part of her character. And, like, she has to adjust to dealing with situations that she normally would be totally fine with under the influence. But, like, trying to head it on sober, and, like, she is struggling to, like, stay focused or, like, stay in, like, be comfortable in her own skin, like, that's just a feeling that needs to be expressed. And just like her slow, like, trying to push forward, and at the very end, like, giving up there in that third episode, to the point where she begins crying on the train, like, that all feels very, very raw in a way that, like, you wouldn't expect from a comic relief character like this. So that's like a really good setup for, like, us, like, also being able to relate to Tuca. And then that continues for the season. She only gets, like, focus episodes less than Bertie, but, like, she still definitely has, like, a lot of different feelings and difficult emotional difficulties that she has to work through.
Yeah, and I would refrain from saying like her problems are a bigger deal than Bertie, but I think her issues are a little more desperate, certainly. Like there's more on the table for her. Like Bertie's gonna be fine. Bertie just got promoted. She has enough money for a down payment in a major city. She has a partner. She's got like a safety network.
Yeah.
But Tuca, like Bertie's literally her whole safety network.
Yeah.
And that's like scary when your safety network moves in with somebody else and you don't live with them anymore. So yeah, it just, there's so much about Tuca. And like they seed things so well, because we find out about her alcoholism by the third episode. And then in the fifth episode, that's when she visits her aunt. And I swear to God, her aunt keeps pushing alcohol on her because she knows she's an alcoholic, and she wants her to like visit more and to need her money. And like that's a whole other like messed up situation. And then yeah, we find out her mom dies and we don't know why until episode 7. And then we find out that she's like so afraid of hospitals because her mom died in a hospital. And so just like I also appreciate that they seed all these things really well, so they leave you wondering, like, oh, that's interesting. Are we going to learn more? And then we do learn more, and the payoff's really good. So, yeah, I feel bad. Like Bertie, she has problems. Like, things are not always going her way. But Tuca, her problems are, like, so much more dire, I feel. And that's, like, part of why I feel more invested in her future happiness. Because, like, it seems more likely she might not actually get it, you know? She has more to lose.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting to talk about that. Like, she doesn't have a support system. And, like, that is a thread that goes throughout the season. Like, her fears of being alone. Like, Tallulah, like, shoves that in her face. Like, you will be abandoned. Mm-hmm. Nobody will be there for you. And, like, in the final episode is where, like, she usually gets a call from her family every year. And this is the time that she doesn't get it. And even though she's complained in the past, now she's like, wait, but if they're not calling, that means that they don't care about me anymore. And like the feeling of abandonment comes in, something that she's already felt earlier in the season with Bertie moving in with her boyfriend. So like it's consistent, and it's feelings that a lot of us have had. So it's just that Tuca is great. Like she's very, also not to be discounted, she is pretty funny. Like she's got a lot of moments. For sure. But like the fact that they are able to add the emotional depth on her on top of that, like, just makes her a really excellent character. So while we had a lot of Tuca, Bertie, I think, is the show pushing as the main character, since she gets like a lot more of the plots in this show. And also she has like maybe deeper emotional issues that she needs to work through too. Like, at the beginning of the season, it's more focusing on her dealing with her anxiety, which is a very big deal. And, like, I especially appreciated the smaller things of, like, her just needing something as simple as, like, special shoes when she needs to, like, feel comfortable in her space. She has trouble speaking up at work. Those are the kind of like everyday things that like anxiety kind of just like freezes you up from doing. I think they literally like show somebody freezing up on like an ice cube at some point. But like how did you guys feel about that part of her of like dealing with anxiety throughout the season? Sam?
I don't really know what to say. Like, I thought it was interesting. I don't want to say it was good, because like anxiety isn't good, but I thought the portrayal of it was good, you know what I mean? It was something that I guess doesn't get like a lot of spotlight time in media, so I appreciated that.
Ally?
I really, well, personally found it relatable, especially with the, like, I'm losing my shit for no reason, for all of the reasons, you know? Like, just thinking about anything that could go wrong. I think if it, like, you know, sometimes social anxiety or just anxiety in general, if it does get traction, it's made fun of her being like, you're just, like, you know, calm down, you'll be fine. I like how, like, in the song they were like, she needs to stay in bed or take meds, and she's like, you know, I mean, I'd rather be doing anything than losing my shit. I don't know. I thought it was done well, but I also like that she, you know, was able to handle herself and like able to still, like Tuca was like, you can't go out of the house without me when they were fighting, but you know, she still was able to do that. She has a job. She's able to go get like the apprenticeship with her help, but still she can do it. She's like a functioning person, bird, dude, lady with anxiety. And it's nice to see like someone who's just like, you know, not cooped up in their house with anxiety.
Yeah. And like, speaking of Tuca, like I also enjoy like, you know, the support system that she's built around her. Like Speckle is like, can detect the symptoms beforehand, is like trying to ease her worries a little bit. Even Tuca is like generally aware of it and is like she pushes on some things, but there are like some small things where she's like, I know you're in this way, so I'm not going to like push it. So like,
yeah.
So I enjoyed that also, that detail of like, you know, having supportive people around you when it's noticeable that you're dealing with those issues. Michelle, anything you want to add?
No, I feel like they pretty much covered it. I mean, I guess just, it hadn't occurred to me that she actually is like a pretty high functioning person with anxiety, but that certainly does seem to be the case given, yeah, like she's killing it at her job and she's in like a good long, she, I do find it very relatable that she was like so afraid that Speckle was going to break up with her if everything wasn't perfect. And when she like broke down during the role playing, she's like, but I'm not a bad girl. She's like, oh no, why are you crying? Like, I thought we were having fun. Like that kind of stuff. Like, I don't think I would react quite that way, but it still like feels like a very anxious kind of response. And I love when the humor can kind of come into it too. Like it's still relatable, but at least we can kind of laugh about it in recognition of what it is. So I appreciate the show for that.
Mm-hmm. And definitely the I'm losing my shit musical number, which lasts like 2 or 3 minutes, is going for that, right? Like
it's so good.
Yeah, I'll just say I wasn't a fan of the musical numbers in this show, but like I respect the effort for it. But and that definitely like that scene, like you get the sense like they're working with like trying to like make it still funny, but like also like recognizing like what's going on in her head, sort of thing. So that's a big part of her in the first half, along with like her, and that's wrapped into her work situation, because also a big thing of this season is her also dealing with sexual harassment in various forms as well, because first in her work at Condé Nast, she's trying to get a promotion, but she's being ignored for being a quiet woman in the workplace. Also, this Dirk guy begins like commenting on her boobs, and then later on, you have Pastry Pete also being very, very close in contact with her, to the point where like she's like getting her face pressed without her consent into like a hot bowl, and just in general being kind of skeezy around her. And so, and also we deal with like Bertie like struggling through her emotions in dealing with these situations, and like this is something that in animation is not treated that often. Mm-hmm. What did you guys think about the representation of the various those like workplace situations in the show? Ally?
Well, with Pastry Pete, at least, I was honestly at first a little confused because, you know, what happens in the bathroom. I did think, like, she was eventually going to cheat on Speckle, so I'm very glad they went the opposite route. Like, I cannot tell you how happy I am, especially because of the video they took, and, you know, they were basically like, fuck the police at this guy. And with Tuca, just, you know, how she helps Bertie in the office place. I thought it was, like, funny, even though, you know, nobody can do that well realistically. Like, like that's the alarm that sounds when a woman hasn't talked. Like, we need more of those, especially in office places. But, I mean, I thought it was done well, but, you know, obviously not, you know, the people who watch that don't use it as an example, because it doesn't always work that way, but it would be nice if it did.
Mm-hmm. And I'd say there's while it's going over the top, like there are still some things that you can take out. Like you might not have like a person like standing on the table and be like, hey, let the woman talk, but like you can be supportive and like give the woman opportunities to talk.
Yeah, like, actually, like, I forgot, like the WOTUS meetings.
Yeah, that's another big part of this as well. Like trying to help her develop her voice and like be more assertive in those things. Michelle, do you have any words?
So I mean, one thing I appreciate about the show is, like, I know Lisa Hannah Walt, she was saying, like, look, this isn't like an animated show for women. This is from a female perspective, but this is a show everyone can enjoy. And I felt like, oh, that's like a cool power move, and also like, damn, that's a good point. Like, lady, like, shows with ladies in them aren't just for fucking ladies. Like, whoever thinks that is like so stupid. And I think like this show definitely seems to feel that it is important to talk about these things like as a through line. But I don't think it's because it's a lady show. I think it's because it's doing this work of trying to dismantle the normalization of these things happening, right? Mm-hmm. And pointing a finger, be like, look, like, actually, this isn't cool. And this is how people think about it, whether you know it or not. Like, maybe, like, try not to be so gross, person who might be watching this. Like, look, like, this, they don't like it. So maybe people in your real life might not like it either. Which, like, I think is a good thing to do regardless. So, like, I wouldn't say, like, oh, it's, like, this, like, lady agenda. It's like, no. It's just, like, dismantling, like, what we normally see. And that's good. It is good.
Decent human agenda.
Yeah. The pastry Pete thing, I feel like, is a little different from, is the coworker of the rooster Dirk? Is that his name?
Yeah.
Because he's, like, just, like, a straw. Like, this is a gross person. Ew. No one likes him. Whereas pastry Pete, like Ally was saying, like, because like he does that weird thing, and like at first I was like, is she anxious because like she has anxiety and so she's like nervous that he's touching her? Like, it's a little like, you don't really get it until we get to the episode where the new girl's there and she like calls him out so quickly and confronts Bertie, and that, like, and then you have to grapple with it. It's like, well, why didn't we think it was weird when we first saw it, like, even as viewers? And it's not until you get to the next episode, the Jelly Lake, that you really understand. It's like, oh shit, like, of course, if you've been sexually assaulted, your perception of sexual interactions, like, is totally shifted forever. Like, you don't know what's necessarily normal or okay if you've already been assaulted before. So, like, of course she wasn't sure in the moment, like, if it was wrong. Like, fortunately, that other girl, like, she knew and she called it out, and like, hopefully, you know, bad things like that won't keep happening to her. But like, it just, like, it makes so much sense for Bertie's character once we get that part of her backstory, that it, like, that's why I feel so ambiguous.
Yeah.
And I think that was like really well done. You can definitely tell like they had like a good team with them handling something like that so nuanced, because not everyone could pull that off. Like,
yeah,
but it is really good. So that I appreciate Pastry Pete's thing like in a slightly different way, because it feels like it hits like home a little more personally for a lot of people probably.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think about that. The backstory does
put
a lot in. Yeah, and like in general, like the reactions that Bertie has to these different things, like it's like a sense of just confusion of like, how am I supposed to react to these things? Like the initial moment of like her getting caught, and what she does first is like, she's so flustered, she goes to the bathroom, she masturbates, like that's what comes in her head initially. And then like she like it has to like think it over once she sees it happening to somebody else and they react differently, and then she feels guilty with herself of like, why didn't I react the correct way? And
exactly,
and she runs away because she doesn't know what to do with herself, and then that leads to her self reflection at the Jelly Lakes with her past. So like, it's going through a whole spectrum of emotions that happen when something as uncomfortable as that happens, and I think that the ability of this kind of show to be able to do that, like, over the course of a season is just very impressive. And it hits very well, because, like, you do get the confusion that's going on inside Bertie as she's working it out. And as we the audience, are working out, like, what happened and what's going on. So I definitely think that they handled this really well, and with just it's a perspective that you don't see very often, and so that makes it feel very refreshing in its own kind of way. But and I guess we've sort of touched upon it, but like in the Jelly Lakes, that there's the part where we get to Bertie being very hesitant to reach this vacation place, and we get the scene where she's on the beach and she opens up the Tuca that she was abused by a lifeguard when she was a preteen. And that just kind of like part, it's explained throughout that episode. It's like she just gave up swimming, but it's because of that. Just like the memories were haunting her in that way, and so that's also something that doesn't that it was handled very very seriously. Like Tuca is there to support her, but it's something that doesn't get talked about a lot in these kind of shows.
Yeah, I thought that was really. At least the scene itself and all the other, like, the dialogue and how it was told, it was really beautiful in its own way. You know, sort of going at it with the cracked egg art style that we were shown before in the episode, and having it be this unpleasant memory that you have to confront in order to move past other things. Not to say that that is... or should be the case with any and all assault, but I think it really works within the narrative.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Anyone else with comments on this? No? Okay.
Maybe a little later. It's very heavy. Cut the tension
with a knife.
Yeah. We don't really see that kind of thing addressed, like you said, a lot, so it's difficult to talk about, but I think it was done well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They definitely did have a good team, like Michelle said. Like, these people know what they're doing and how to do it properly.
Yeah. And it leaves so much ambiguous. Like, we never get, like, a precise reason exactly why it led to her giving up swimming. But, like, one of the things I really wondered about is because, like, the comment she remembers the lifeguard saying was, like, oh, you look really good in that swimsuit. And so part of me wondered... like you seem older than your age, which is like you know, such a classic thing that we hear from stuff like that where there's a really big age difference, especially with like, you know, you're like a preteen, right? I'm like, you're almost a teenager, you want to feel more mature, you want attention. And I wondered like if the fact that after that thing happened, like she just didn't feel comfortable wearing bathing suits in public anymore, like maybe that was enough to stop her from swimming. Like we're never exactly gonna know why, but like that's something that jumped out at me as a possible reason. But yeah, it is really heavy, and I appreciate that like they built up to it, you know. And I appreciate that like we also like they've shifted the animation style a lot for, you know, flashback things or people recounting memories. They did it a bunch with Tuca stuff with their mom too.
The way they do that is so effective.
And yeah, exactly. And it feels like they choose like a style that fits every mood, right? Because this one felt very like dreamlike, but also kind of like cloudy. Yeah. Probably like her memories of the whole thing are. And so that just like that felt very intentional, and it worked really well at conveying like a hard topic in like an easy to process and consume way from a viewer standpoint.
So yeah, Bertie has gone through a lot in this season. It ends on a bit of a clean note because like we have the whole the viral video of Pastry Pete confronting Bertie, and that's enough to sink his business, and he gets a giant bird shit from the sky on him.
Yeah,
so, you know, but it helps even if it's a little clean. But I think like it helps the show like end on like kind of an uplifting note, and like that's kind of the mood that most of the show is anyway. Like it's uplifting, so it feels at least like in terms of like a vibe, like it feels more accurate for the show as a whole.
Yeah, Allie, I don't know if it was you or Sam who said, like, this show, it's not BoJack, but the biggest difference is, like, you know, tonally, it's a lot more upbeat, and I think, like, that's, like, that's a really on display the last episode. It's like, that guy gets his comeuppance, like, Dirk gets his comeuppance, too. Like, we don't end on depression and sadness. We end on, like, them making up their friendship and renting a hawk in the sky, and it's great, and I think, like, that's so good.
How does that work?
I don't know. I have no idea. Like,
so confusing.
There was a lady who was a dog who like had a dog on a leash at one point. So, like, I don't know how any of that works. But, like, I think It's so good because, like, it's hard enough, honestly, to, like, be a lady in the world. Like, if we had, like, a depression lady show, I feel like that would be, like, so harsh. So, yeah. I appreciate
it. It would be my show.
Right. It's Sam's time. It's coming.
Yeah, that's my. I'll pitch out the Netflix.
Yeah. I do appreciate this show for, like, deciding to be, like, upbeat at the end of the day, though. Like, it can get deep and heavy, but, like, that's not the show's identity. Very clearly, and like I appreciate that a lot. People need like easy, nice things that make them feel good to watch sometimes, and this show does both. Like, it makes you think and it feels good to watch it, and that's like very honorable, honestly. You do not need to be sad to be like a good show, clearly.
Yeah And moving to the third main character of sorts, Speckle, voiced by Steven Yeun, like he is also like a kind of character who's got a lot of funny moments, but also has a little bit of serious moments. Ally, you seem to have wanted to talk about him. Please tell us why you love Speckle.
What's not to love? He's the best boy. I mean, I just love how, first of all, how supportive he is, even though, you know, when. The only instance I can think of is when Bertie like is AWOL for a while, and she goes to the jam, whatever the place is with Tuca, and she doesn't contact him. He's like, you know, he stands up for himself. He's not like a pushover, but he's also not a terrible dude. And I really appreciate that they didn't go with like the cheating route like I thought they would do, even though, you know, I wasn't going to be upset about it because obviously women cheat too. It's not just a man thing. But I don't know, he's awkward and funny, and when he gets drunk, he's amazing, and I love Yun. He is my husband. Not really, I wish he was.
He's very handsome.
So attractive. I also didn't know he could sing until the Losing My Shit song, so that makes him more attractive. But mostly just because he, you know, like Tuca and Bertie, he has traits and quirks that are really relatable, like freezing, like when someone tells you to freeze and they don't move. That I thought that was funny. And when Bertie leaves the apartment, yeah. He looks around and then he farts. It was just little things. I don't know. He's the best. He gets just the right amount of love, and I like how they're treating him.
All right. Sam, do you have any speckle thoughts?
I like it in the first episode when he has a picture of himself in his mouth. And then it's really cute. I don't know, like, I don't really feel as attached to him as Ally does, unfortunately. I'm sorry. I like Steven a lot. He's like such an amazing actor, and I think he does a wonderful job here. But Speckle, it's himself. He's just like, he's like the nice boyfriend of my friend, and like, like I'm like in a Tuca situation.
You're
like,
Tuca. You're
in a situation where that's like, really, yeah, cool. Like I like him. He's not a bad person, and like he's cool, but like, I'm not here to hang out with him.
Yeah. You might actually sometimes get like a you can do so much better vibe from Bertie, maybe. I don't know. I kind of, not like so much better, but like, girl, look at your options kind of
thing. I think Speckle's a good, like he's a valid person, and like he deserves love and stuff. Yeah. And you know what? Him and Bertie, that can work out if they so choose. Yeah. But you know, for me, it's just like, I'm not dating him.
Yeah.
Well, it's like that thing of where he like walks into a different room. It's like, don't talk about me while I'm gone. And Tuca's just like, we never won't. Do.
Burn.
Yeah. I also like his little freeze thing as well, yeah. Where he's just frozen for like 10 hours while they try to get. Okay, who keeps their grandmother's ashes inside of
I
a
know! Like, he's had a weird family tradition. He didn't, like, warn her. He put it next to the other sugar. He put it in the food cabinet. What? I mean, what do you think was going to happen?
And then she was a cake.
It was hilarious.
I love how weird the show gets. I didn't expect that, but it's
I really
fantastic.
Like his architecture job scenes when he's just like crawling
out about buildings.
Like, he's the bad boy of architecture. He drew a window. Like, oh my god,
and he I love that. Really sound, yeah.
And yeah, when he's drunk at Aunt Lulu's house, he's like this. He's basically like this architecture set scene.
When he puts on the see-through like robe, it was great. He knows how to have fun too. He let loose a little. Good for him.
But yeah, I think because Speckle is great, and I think Ally hits it right on the head. Where it's like he's really nice and supportive of Bertie when he can, but like also like he does push back when Bertie is like he is pushing him away. Like he is the one who has like, hey, we're a relationship. You need to keep me in the loop on things, and like that's something that like it keeps it from feeling like a one sided relationship. The fact that like he is able to state his desires for what the relationship should be like without it feeling overbearing. Yeah, and like Bertie,
it's so reasonable, and you don't really, well, not that you don't get that a lot, but it is kind of rare to see that represented.
Mm-hmm.
I think.
Yeah.
Michelle, do you have any Speckle thoughts?
I feel like Ally thought way more about Speckle than I ever did in the show. I was either like neutral or like, haha, that was funny. In relation to Speckle the whole time. But like now I'm actually like I do think he deserves a little more credit. It's hard to, when you're with someone and you feel so sure and they don't feel that sure about like the future. I think like them trying to buy the house was really good example, because he was just like, yeah, this will just be our starter home, and then we can get another house, maybe we can build a house in 30 years. Well, that's okay, because I like you now, and I feel fine. Whereas, like, Bertie, that's so not how she, like, she is so, a lot of her anxiety is, like, wanting to feel like everything is fine, and that she's pleasing everyone, and feeling safe, but like uncertainty is her enemy. And so like the house thing just totally freaked her out. And I think he handled it really well. I mean, when she kind of pushed him away, like he stands up for himself, but he also makes like impulse purchases and buys like the worst house so that he can rebuild it. And I love that, because it's like, yeah, dude, like, you're allowed to, like, have your moment to splurge, too. And he, like, says he does it because, like, she gets to do what she wants all the time. Yeah. He wanted to do something he wanted to do. Yeah, and it's, like, it's just, like, it's framed in such, like, a kind of, like, aw, honey sort of way that, like, you can't be mad at him. He's just, like, trying to cope with the situation the way that that makes sense to him. So, I think he's, like, honestly a pretty good boyfriend. Like, he's not the star of the show, but like that's as it should be for a show called Tuca and Bertie. It's not Tuca and Bertie and Speckle. So I feel like he fills out his role very well for what it is.
I agree.
Yeah, even that moment, like, at the end, where, like, he's like, I'm allowed to blow up at you. He's, like, in a different character's hand, that might, like, feel too, like, ugly. But, like, for some reason, coming out of Speckle, it's like, well, yeah, you earned this. Like,
you're entitled to feel that way.
Yeah.
At least like, in this situation.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he's just, like, you get that he's really sad and confused and, like, doesn't really know how to, what happened or how to really respond to it in a great way. So, yeah, you just feel for him. You don't really judge him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, we've covered the three main characters. I guess we can get a little bit into the odds and ends here. I guess we'll talk a little bit about minor characters. I don't know if you guys have a favorite of, like, the one-offs or, like, the lesser characters.
Okay, yes, well, the lesbians.
Yes, the coach and her wife.
Okay, sorry. Sam, please tell us what you liked about the lesbians.
Oh, man, I love everything about them. Oh, God, hold on.
Coach
I need to...
Meredith.
Yes.
Coach Meredith. My God, Jane Lynch voiced Coach Meredith? How did I not pick up
Hell
on
yeah.
that?
Hell yeah.
Oh, that's amazing casting.
Fuck, and what was her wife's name?
I don't know.
It's lost the time.
English, though. She plays a coach. That's great.
And her wife is an owl.
Oh, yeah. She was so wonderful. She was an artist. And she made egg art, and she like explained it so wonderfully. And she's just, I love them, and I want to just either be them when I grow up, be one of them, preferably the artist one. Either that, live next to them, have them be my neighbors, have them be like my aunts.
Yes.
Like come into my life like every Christmas or whatever and buy me just like gay shit, and I'm just like, thank you. Or just be like my best friends. Like I meet them somewhere, like maybe like a gay community center, and like I meet them and I'm like, oh my god, you guys are so great. And they like adopt me as their pseudo lesbian daughter, even though like I'm in my mid 20s and they're like 60, 70 years old. And it'll be great.
Lesbians and their young adoptive daughter.
Yes. Yeah. We'll be a happy family if I was in this universe. But I loved everything about them. You know, people say that that sort of dynamic, that, you know, the harsh, sort of more masculine woman who would be the Jane Lynch Coach Meredith character in this situation, and the more, you know, gentle, quote-unquote sensitive, more femme character, those are sort of overplayed tropes and stereotypes. That's bullshit. It's still, you know, people live their lives like this. And you know what? It's great. And I love it. So shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
There you go.
Preach. Yeah, and I just want to say about Owl, I enjoyed that she is also like doing a lot of like joking around and stuff, and she's so like she like is portrayed as like kind of serious at first, but like she loosens up and like they're just happy together, so it's great.
It's fun.
Sam, would you jet ski with them if they offered you jet skis?
Honestly, I'd be really afraid because I've never jet skied before, but if like, they were jelly, like,
you'll be fine.
If the owl was behind me and Coach Meredith was in front of me and I was just like hugging on the Coach Meredith and like they made like a little Sam sandwich out of me of love, then that would be fine. I would be okay with that. They could protect me.
Okay. Michelle, do you have a favorite side character out of this bunch?
I have to remember. This is not a favorite. Just stand out randomly. That Stallion 69, whatever his name was. Loving him because he's just a random guy trying to like get his rocks off or whatever. And then this lady's like, "I need help," and so he drives like 7 hours and he's constantly like, "Is this creepy? Might be creepy. Oh well, I'm still gonna do it." Takes her to the hospital and ends up bonding hardcore with Speckle. Right? He bonds with Speckle
a little bit. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I just know like, they do.
Yeah, like, what a great guy. Like, sometimes strangers on the internet, like, save the day and help you get your egg removed from your uterus. So I loved his character. Fine. He was, like, such a force for good. Like, he could have been some, like, you know, tropey, skeevy, like, you know, like, virginal gamer who is in the alt-right. But, like, no, he's just, like, a sweet guy who, like, helps someone out.
Alt-right?
Yeah.
Down a road.
Yeah, that incel gamer.
I know, yeah. Like, he like wasn't at all. He was just like a really sweet guy, and I love that he was a character in the show. Yeah, I really liked him.
What was his name? Oh yeah, it was Joel.
Yeah, it was Joel.
But no, Joel. Joel. Stallion 69.
I'll never call you that.
Only because 68 was taken.
Exactly.
Allie, do you have a favorite minor character here?
I want to say Draka, just because she's a plant. I've assumed she's a weed that smokes weed and has a bunch of turtles, and it's just fucking weird.
I was expecting her to be a bigger part of the show.
Me too. But she kind of was. She helped Tuca out of her rut in the end. It was nice. Like she
adopted a cat.
Oh, yeah, the jaguar.
Yeah, she adopted the jaguar.
And, well, just everybody in this show is weird. I love how, like, there are also plant people. I didn't expect that either.
The teens.
Yes. Oh, the teens.
Oh, my God. Never tell are we mean?
Sarcastic or not. Yeah.
I don't think so.
That's so true, because teens are inherently very intimidating to people who are, like, 20s, 30s. But teens are just like, okay.
Don't trust them. They never tell the truth.
Like, are we mean?
You never know if they're talking ironically, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I liked Aunt Tallulah until she got bitchy about her mom. I was like, oh, you better step off.
Step off that.
That was quite the turn, yeah.
Oh, yeah, who else was... I can't think of anybody else. Maybe.
The robot guy from the clinic who like ran away with the lamp wife. Like I liked him. He was
Ultra Sam. Sam.
Oh, yeah, Ultra Sam. Yeah,
no, he was hilarious.
Look at my fucking wife. It was fun.
But it's a lamp.
They get in the car and they drive away.
Oh, yeah. I murder a guy.
They're not plugged in. Like, how can they get into a car?
On love energy, Sam.
Is it like in the Brave Little Toaster how they had to like strap a battery onto a rolling chair so they can move?
Yes,
it's just like that. Sure,
that's exactly the same.
Following that line, do the plant people in this universe have to like continuously water themselves? Like
they should. Like... Yeah, it's I mean,
what happens in winter? Do they
everybody
just die?
Waters themselves because we can't live without water.
Yeah, the plant people have to stay inside in the winter. They're not allowed.
Yeah, they have heat lamps and stuff. Yeah. Maybe they go to like greenhouses, like on holiday and stuff.
Oh yeah, yeah. there's a lot to build on this universe, and just like this in general, like just speaking to like the character designs of this universe, it's definitely a lot more looser than like BoJack Horseman, which like sticks to making stuff as anthropomorphic as possible. Like you do get the plant people. I think there's one person who just has a rose for a head.
Yeah.
So a lot more variety in the designs there, and also like talking to the animation style of the show in general, like we've already talked, like it's very colorful and it like shifts a lot, like using different styles. We already talked a little bit about some of the flashbacks, like we had Tuca's mom as she's talking about her, it's like popsicle stick and yarn, and the representation of her dying is just undoing the string.
That was like, so like, I mean, yeah. It was done very well, but I still felt really depressed watching.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. I'll say that the Sets Bugs episode, there's not much that I got out of it. But
Sex bugs,
Alex. The sex bugs are so horny.
They just wanna hump things. You but I will
the,
say
the,
that
the thumbnail image.
They're very like buff, I will say. All like pretty contoured bodies.
They're attractive.
I was gonna say like, well, let's stick into this. Do you think they're attractive?
Sure.
What was the one? Athena is pretty. She can get it.
She was pretty cool. I'm impressed you remember any of their names.
Too.
No, because Tuca mentioned her because she was like, yeah, she's the smartest one.
Oh, and she wears like, glasses! She, yeah!
Yeah, and she had, like, Calvin Klein underwear and stuff.
Yeah, she could do that.
I know we're not gonna make too many comparisons to BoJack, but they kind of reminded me of the Ant Warriors when they're, like, underground. So also, like, very buff and, you know, just wanna hump things. But yeah, just back to the animation style. In that episode, like, I didn't get too many laughs of it, but I will say when it switched to the hand puppet representation of Tuca getting bugs from the bushes, I, like, I like did a spit take there.
I didn't think that was a true story. I was so confused.
I'm not sure if in the end it is true, but it was enough to win that trial. But yeah, we use hand puppets. And then like throughout the show, like we also have like the words coming out of characters, representing their actions.
Yeah,
kinda,
I really like
comic
it.
Book-y.
Like the lists and like even on the characters, like when Bertie like is pulling her eyes back and it says, "Why bother?"
Oh,
just
yeah.
Stuff like that.
There's so many good screenshot moments.
There really are.
The show.
Yeah, the visual gags are definitely like one every minute, and like a lot, like so many of them are great. It would be too hard to remember all of them.
God, normie life bullshit is my favorite. What, even though it's like in the first episode, I want to post that to everybody's Facebook when I see that they are either A, having a baby, B, getting married, C, buying a house.
Mm-hmm.
Or D, doing normie life bullshit that aren't those things. Because it's so like, yeah, I'm not
it's
normie.
True.
I might make that my fucking like cover photo,
do
but
it.
That might
do
get
it.
Me in trouble.
Yes.
Oh, like on Facebook?
Yeah.
That will get you in trouble. Facebook's not the police.
Are you not doing? Do they not let you do curse words?
No, they do. It's just like in trouble with people who I'm friends with.
Oh. They'll feel sub, well, not sub-tweeted, but sub-Facebooked that yes. You posted that? Yeah, okay.
I think you can pick your battle, Sam, but you should also live your true life, so...
Right now, my cover photo is Todd from BoJack, from the Christmas special, saying I like it when people on TV hug each other.
Aww. That's very you.
Yeah. I do like it when people hug each other.
Well, there's a lot of hugging in this show.
And there is! And I like it.
The scene where they, oh my god, when Tuca and Bertie make up in the car and they just look at each other and cry.
Yeah.
That was done so well. The car really felt like tears. How good of friends they are, and it just made me emotional.
Yeah, and they're just like in the middle of a sheep field.
Thing was so weirdly relatable to me because in Utah, it's happened at least 5 times. We used to drive up to meet my grandparents on my mom's side. Like the goat, like there'll be guys on horses and there'll be one like sheep herding dog, and then just like a sea of woolly bodies, and they come in a stream and they cover every nook and cranny around your car. And it takes at least 20 minutes for them to leave and, like, move on down the road. So I actually, like, personally love that a lot.
Strangely it's, specific.
Yeah, it does happen sometimes. In real life, the sheep will come.
If you build it.
Yeah, the sheep will come.
If you drive it, I guess.
If you drive it, the sheep will come. They'll cover the road.
Damn.
So now I guess, obviously we're not going to talk about all the episodes, but, like, if you guys have a favorite that you want to, like, dig into, like, Sam, of these 10, like, what would you say is the episode you enjoyed the most?
We already touched on episode 9, like, a billion, mm-hmm. jillion times, but that was my favorite. I think one gag we didn't talk about was Girl Things.
Oh, yeah.
Which was supposed to be, like, Claire's.
It was so funny.
That was good.
And, like, the commercial, like, get the fuck out of my room, Mom!
I'm not gonna order pizza!
So, hashtag, well, not to me, but to somebody. I don't know.
It's a very, like, 90s girl childhood kind of commercial gag. Yeah. So
I don't know. When was the last time anybody's been to Claire's? I think it's...
I have.
Allie
has. 2013?
They still have them in the malls.
Yeah, they do.
It's crazy.
And last time I was in there, it was, like, in the middle of the flower crown trend, so they were selling flower crowns. So me and my friend just, like, put them on and wouldn't take them off, and it was wonderful.
Did you shoplift, though? That's the real question.
No.
Is that, like, a rite of passage at Claire's? You have to shoplift?
Oh, just because they shoplifted there.
God, I'm
that's
not... not...
That's who they did.
Maybe it is a rite of passage to shoplift at Claire's,
I think it is, but I never have.
Well, maybe it's to shoplift at an abandoned mall, because almost like this mall was very run down. So.
When the old person fell over and was like, the mall has claimed me, and she turned into like a vending machine. That was such an amazing gag. Oh my god.
It really was.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh, the mall's claimed her. Oh, shit.
It's abandoned. All the old people keep falling over and turning into things.
Oh, the mall is
mall walkers.
Mall walkers.
Yeah. That's why nobody goes in there anymore.
But yeah, I think that episode really hit the point home that, like, of course it has the serious stuff with the sexual assault stuff, and sort of overcoming your demons a bit. But then it also has, like, a lot of funny shit in it, and it has the lesbians. It just has it all. And it's, for me, it's the example of everything the show is doing right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that definitely makes sense, yeah. I'll also use this opportunity to mention Girl Things. At the end of each of these episodes, there are like 5 to 15 second like stingers at the end of the episodes. In this one, it was crab things, and it's just like the same person but with crabs.
Crab things,
the baby.
Which, as I think, that was also like
they
the most
eat
successful.
The baby's arm.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It's coming back to me now.
So the sister eats the baby's arm, and then the mother eats the whole baby.
Yeah, crab things.
Yeah, so I think that was the most successful of the stingers, or at least that's the one I remember.
I agree.
Allie, do you have a favorite episode of this group that we haven't really talked about?
Okay, that we haven't really talked about. Probably episode 2 with the promotion, because we also got to see how, like, you know, female in the workplace, also somebody with anxiety in the workplace, and also sexual assault in the workplace. Like, not assault, but, like, you know, being called... catcalled when you don't want it, and then I thought it was fucking weird, but funny how the boob plops out. Like, I mean, some girls, you know, we have that one boob who really does carry
all the weight.
Just all the, yeah, exactly. They make, like, they, their back hurts from carrying everything. And I thought that was really funny. I didn't expect it, but it was great. Trying to think of the other one. Maybe, I guess, the one with the aunt.
So Plumage?
Maybe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's my favorite too.
All right. I have, so I have an off-topic question.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Sort of. How do you pronounce the word aunt? Aunt or aunt?
Aunt.
I go aunt. Yeah.
I flip-flop because I'm shitty.
Well, they say aunt in the show, and I was like, I wonder how many people actually say aunt and how many people say aunt.
It's totally a regional thing is what I've learned.
I knew people from where I lived who said aunt, so I don't
know. I feel like Northeasterners say aunt a lot. At least that was my impression from going to school in Massachusetts.
Dylan says aunt.
Yeah, that checks out. Totally aunt territory.
I'll say aunt when I'm not addressing my aunt, but if I say, like, if I'm talking to them, I'll be like, hey, Aunt Debbie or something.
Yeah, hey, aunt.
Yeah.
I have found a New York Daily News picture of the occurrence of aunt versus aunt.
Oh my God.
Most of the country uses aunt, and Northeasters use aunt.
Dude, that's what I'm saying. Girls at Smith always said aunt. I was like, aunt. What is this? Awful alternate universe.
That checks out for Dylan and Allie geographically.
Yeah, because it seems like also Virginia for some reason is like a pocket of people who use aunt. That's like different from the redness of the rest of the map. So yeah, there's your aunt versus aunt discussion.
Aunt outweighs aunt by like 98%. That's so enlightening.
Yeah.
All right, sorry to interrupt that.
That was important.
That was
very
important. Your favorite
very important.
No, it's a valid question. I think that's it. That's all I had. Yeah. Definitely the last episode. Not sorry. 9 is the best.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Michelle, do you have an episode that we haven't talked about yet?
Oh my God. An ant literally crawled on me. You asked that. I won't kill it right now because we're in the middle of a podcast.
Kill it on air. Kill it on air. Let's see what noise it makes.
Okay, he looks dead. My cat didn't do anything. Thanks, Boo. Nothing.
Is it an aunt now?
Oh no.
God.
It's always an aunt. It's an aunt either way. Plumage, episode 5 was also one of my favorites. That and 9, I agree with Ally. Those are like the strongest. I really like the open house too. But that one, I mean, Plumage like is probably one of the like not as funny episodes because both of the plots are kind of suck. Like Tuca's, well, it starts out really friendly with her and her aunt, but then like slowly, like you get the sense of that Aunt Tallulah is like picking on her more and more, and like you don't really get why until they finally have an argument and Tuca leaves, and then Aunt Tallulah is like sitting there all alone. You just get like, oh, so yeah, she does really have no one, and her way of coping with that is like picking on Tuca and making Tuca feel really insecure about her life. And I swear to God, enabling her drinking, she gives her like 5 or 6 drinks over the course of that one evening, which like to me feels like it's on purpose. And saying all this awful stuff about how like Tuca's not smart and as bad as her mom and is never going to amount to anything. And like, you just get the sense that Aunt Tallulah's like really not having a great life and maybe uses money as a way to try to get people to connect with her. But like, it's, I mean, anything built on money is like a way to force relationships, not going to end well. So just a lot to chew on there. And Bertie's whole thing, like that's when the fixer man comes over, right?
The it fixer is creepy. Man. Yes.
I don't.
Puncher. No.
Yes.
Handyman.
Handyman. Fixer handyman. And so, like, she's, like, she, like, shreds up her cute outfit, and, like, it's really self-conscious. And at the end, that's when, like, Pastry Pete does the creepy head thing, and she ends up masturbating, and it's just, like, so, like, there's a lot to kind of parse both sides of that, the A and B plots. And so, it just, like, it stuck out for a number of reasons, but maybe it could have been funnier, but like it didn't have to be because other episodes did it nicely. But that was one of my favorites.
Yeah, and that episode is also the one where she goes to the Woodist meeting and you have stuff like putting the potato down your pants and her finding her mantra.
Boob! Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
And then Tuca later with the jar, look, I have a third boob.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'll just say with the deli guy, like, I think the focus is on Tuca, so we already talked about, like, her deal in that episode, but, like, also, like, Bertie, the whole thing of, like, Setsu is very predictable, and we gotta figure out, like, what each of us likes, and then it, like, turns into Bertie, like, just really liking this British show. But then, like, we also get, like, the conversation with Speckle, where, like, he initially has the disconnect of, like, I don't get it, like, what is this supposed to mean, and, like, Bertie has to, like, come out and say, like, I don't like that I'm never surprised by these things, and then it feels, like, very sweet at the end, where he's, like, all in on this, and, like, gets into the British role play, so I think that both that sides of the so episode good. Are funny.
That was really
that. That was one of my favorite parts.
Nuts of Knittingfield's a great sounding show. And also, can we talk about how Speckle's idea of, like, porn is literally, like, what his life already is right now in his actual relationship? That is so funny to me.
Can we also talk about how he wanted to watch the sequel of Nests of Netherfield?
This is what you find sexy. You want me to ignore you for 15 years and give you a peck on the beak? You're missing the point.
Is that sexy?
I mean, not on its own. It's like dynamics.
She was explaining. It's about, like, the longing of it.
Yeah,
you know?
The past. Romantic. The forbidden. Yeah. Also, in the end, when they both, like, die on top of each other, and then the castle literally collapses off the cliff, it's another amazing gag. I, like, lost my mind. It was so funny.
Also, the peeping Tom weird.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's, like, narrating as his hand was, like, slowly moving down. It's like, oh, look, something new is gonna happen. No, it just grabs the boob again. But
I love bird watching.
Oh, yeah, that creepy, like, teenage girl's great.
Yeah. So, before we begin wrapping up, two small things I do want to talk about. First, podcasts. We are a podcast, and there are two podcasts mentioned in this show. First, in the first episode, I think, Tuca is listening to Breakfast Talk, brought to you by Oval Space, hosted by Billy Eggs. So we should host a breakfast podcast. I think that would be good.
So today I ate a Lunchable that was a breakfast Lunchable. It's called a Brunchable.
Oh my god.
I saw it at the grocery store the other day, and I was like, oh my god, I have to have this. So it was breakfast sausage and cheese, and it had a blueberry muffin. It was fine.
Okay, well, that's a game changer. Brunchables. I had what did I have? I had Fruit Loops.
I had nothing.
Okay.
Michelle, what did you eat for breakfast?
Yeah, Michelle.
Oh, I had Cheerios, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, I had Cheerios.
Okay. Yeah, did they make you cheery?
They gave me the energy to run for the bus, so they did their job, yeah.
Yeah. Cheerios, the healthier version of Fruit Loops. So.
Nah, I mean, the Honey Nut ones, no, which are the only kind that make sense. The other ones just taste like garbage.
Mm-hmm,
except
mm-hmm.
for the maple syrup ones.
Wait!
The maple syrup ones?
I didn't know that! They're so where do you buy those, Allie?
ShopRite, maybe.
ShopRite.
Do you guys have that have where you live? I don't know.
Okay. And the second podcast brought up was Bird Justice, which Speckle had in his car. Apparently the first four episodes were talking about how, like, somebody murdered somebody, but the fifth episode was about how the court system works, which is the one that Tuca did not want to listen to. So there are your two podcasts.
I like those podcasts. We're not like any of those podcasts. We're more loosey-goosey.
Yeah. I think Tuca would like listening to us.
Oh yeah.
Oh, she would.
Tiffany Haddish, listen to our podcast.
Yeah, Tiffany Haddish, Lisa Hanwalt, listen to our podcast and then put it in your show. Yes. Please.
Put it in her podcast. Plug for Baby Geniuses.
Oh, she does have a podcast. Oh my god, everybody has a podcast. We had a podcast long before you all had a podcast.
Yeah. Check and the finally receipts. Yeah. Go in our logs, find our Lego Movie 2 podcast where we also talk about Tiffany Haddish. Yeah. Finally, cold, hot takes on cold foods. Well, we have crunts and croons. Crunts is a combination of a cruller and a bundt cake, and croons are a combination of a croissant and a bundt cake. Of those two, which would you go for if you had the option of both in a bakery, Michelle?
So the issue is the crunch sounds better, but Pastry Pete made that. So, like, boo. Definitely gotta go for the croon to support Bertie's local business.
Seconded. Nice. What did you say, Allie?
Seconded, so you can skip me.
Okay. Allie. Sam?
So you said that the croon was a croissant and a bundt cake?
Yeah.
What's the croon? It's a
crawler and bundt cake.
What the hell is a crawler?
Yeah, what's a crawler? Hold on, I need to look this up.
It's like a swirly donut.
Yeah, it's like a donut, but like way fucking better.
It's a little sweeter, you know?
Honestly, I would probably have the croon because I don't think a croissant and a bundt cake will go together.
I agree.
I know, but like Pastry Pete had his tainty all over the crunch.
Okay, what about the lemon filled thing that she makes later? I probably wouldn't have that, but like I don't like lemon and sweets, I'm sorry.
What about that spaghetti thing she makes that?
Ooh, the spaghetti thing.
Yeah, that looks good. I forget.
Yeah, I would fucking want that right now. It
looks really good.
I'd have the spaghetti thing.
Okay. I think I'd go. I mean, I feel bad that I'm supporting Pastry Pete in this, but like the crunch seems like a more like a reasonable combination of like two sweet things. Whereas a croon, it's like a croissant, which is like dry and buttery, but it's buttery, but it's not going for sweet. Whereas bundt is going for sweet. So like you're combining the two, and the textures are so different too. Like bundt is like really soft, and croissant, like I think it's best when it's like kind of crunchy, you know. So I think that the croont is just from two different worlds. But if Bertie was able to make them together, so she's very talented, but I think I'd be basic and go for the croont.
I think these are based off of the Krona, right?
I think so.
Yeah, they're probably.
Have you ever had a Krona? Even like a knockoff Krona?
I think I have, like. A couple years ago. It was pretty subpar, if I remember.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I had one and I was also unimpressed. I think that the place that sold it put way too much sugar on it. So
that's like
it,
all you could taste?
Well, it felt like a crunchy donut, and that's not what I want from a donut. I don't want to, because you could barely, the only thing the croissant brings is like the heart, it's harder than a donut, right? So it's like, I'd rather just have a donut that's soft and easy to eat than like one that like crumbles on
me. Yeah. Well, now I'm just looking at a list of donut combinations, and people were making donut chicken sandwiches and like donut mac and cheese sandwiches, and it's like disgusting. Why would you do that?
Yeah.
Dunkin' has like donut fries, right?
Donut fries make sense because it's already fried dough. It's already fried dough. It's fine. It's not potatoes. Okay. It's fucking fried dough.
Okay, this is the real thing, though. Did you guys know that munchkins, like the donut holes, are made out of, like, cake, like, batter, not donut stuff? Isn't that crazy? No wonder they taste so much better than a normal donut.
Blueberry munchkins are my favorite.
Yeah, they're really... Those ones, the chocolate ones, are so good.
I'm a glazed munchkin kind of person. The glazed ones also taste
good. Yeah, they're all good. The munchkins are just, like, so much better than normal.
They're such a size that you can just, like, keep popping them like chips, you know?
Yeah, sometimes when I was feeling sad, I would just buy myself a pack of, like, 50 munchkins and just have them in my house for a week.
Hell yeah, that sounds so good. See, that would be a power breakfast. That's what we all should be eating. Go for the munchkins.
Yeah. I'm so hungry for donuts. Let's just after this.
Yeah. So we're going to go off to a diner and find donuts, I guess. But before we leave, any final thoughts you want to say about the show before we begin signing off, Sam?
Oh, shit. There was something I wanted to say, and I was like, I should save it for the final thought. Oh, yeah. Okay. I remember now. All right. Okay. So I wasn't expecting to relate to the show too much. A lot like in the vein of like Broad City or Michelle, what was that show with A.D. Bryant?
Who's that?
Shrill?
Shrill, yeah.
Oh, Shrill! Yeah, that show.
I asked Michelle because she watched it too.
I did watch it. I his names.
Not much in the vein of shows like Broad City, Shrill, fucking Pen 15, even at point.
Bicycle.
You know, like a lot of the points where I felt like, oh, kind of alienated because I'm a more butch masculine woman, and it's like, this is for me, and it's for everybody, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I think the point where Lisa Hannibal was like, this is a show for everybody, and I felt that, you know, especially, you know, looking back, like, you know, even though there were situations where I was kind of alien to, there were also situations, like, a lot of Tuca stuff I was feeling, and I was like, oh, I can, like, that's me, hashtag me. And I, like, really applaud the show for that, and I think that's really wonderful, and it is time for women's stories to stop just being for women, you know, especially for, you know, the stereotypical what you would think a woman to be, because women are a bunch of people, you know?
Yeah.
Did that make sense?
Yes, it did.
You know, I'd like women come in all shapes, sizes, etc., so... Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That. Thank you for that, Sam. That was actually like very, very deep thoughts. So
was it?
Thank you.
I tried to say like.
No, but actually, I wanted to add. I didn't ask you this at the beginning, so I guess I'll ask you now. Like, we did see a lot of the comparisons of this show to Broad City, and you brought that up here. Like, what would you say to someone who didn't really like Broad City, but like, what would you say to like the difference between those two shows, given how common that comparison has been?
I think Broad City, like, it's at least like stoner comedy, at least, and it's more, I don't know, I would say it's more grounded, but at the same time more fantastical, and not to say that it has less heart than Tuca and Bertie, but Tuca and Bertie definitely touches in an emotional spot that Broad City doesn't.
All right. Ally, do you have any final thoughts on the show?
Well, we were talking about how... I'm sorry, what is the show creator's name?
Lisa Hannibal.
Yeah.
She said that it's not a show for women, but I appreciate it because it is a show made by women, and it can really feel that, and we need more of it. And this is a perfect example of why, because, like, you know, people are like, women can't make funny, like, raunchy, but this is fucking proof. It's all of that and a bag of chips. That's my final thoughts.
All that and two bags of bird seed.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Yes.
Bags of bird seed, yes.
Exactly.
Michelle?
My thought was gonna be pretty similar to Ally, so I'll just say, like, I know this show had a lot of, like, pressure on it and expectations to be really funny and to be like this standout exemplary like thing that people can point to and be like, see, adult show, female perspective, it can exist and thrive. And it's hard to be, not necessarily, I don't think Lisa's the first, but she's definitely one of like a handful, which is like a handful, and there are a lot of adult cartoons out there, and I think it's hard to have all that pressure on you and for everyone to expect, like, it needs to be amazing or it might not be picked up again or something. And I think this show did a fabulous job just embracing itself. And, like, you get a real sense of, like, the kind of show that it is. And it was only 10 episodes. It's not a lot of time to kind of show the world what you are and what you're about and what your style is and what these characters are and what kind of plots you want to pursue. And I think, like, given all that, they did do a really great job, and I hope they can have the space now to not feel like they need to prove anything anymore and just, like, make the fun, cool show they want to make for as long as they possibly can, because they don't have to be. It's like how I felt, like, right when Rebecca started getting a lot of press, like when the first couple episodes of Steven came out, because, like, oh, first solo female show creator in Cartoon Network's history, 25 years, how do you feel? And poor Rebecca's just like, look, like, I'm just making a show that I want to make, okay? Like, me being a woman should be very real. Like, I get that, like, it's exciting and representation, but, like, that's not all I am, and that's not all that this show is. And I feel like the same courtesy should be bestowed on Lisa. Like, she's just trying to make the best show that she thinks is funny and fun, and I hope she, like, feels like she has the space to do that now that the first season's dropped, and it has been very well received. So, yay, I want to see more. I want to see more soon, but not too soon, because they deserve to take their time. But please, like, 10 more seasons of this. It's so good.
Yeah, and I'll definitely say, like, it's true that at least, like, from people who are, like, watching the animation business and, like, want more women to be given these kind of, like, high positions. It's, like, in that sense, there's a lot of pressure. But, like, watching the show, it feels like it can totally stand on its own. And, like, it does, like, so many incredible things that I think... It does enough that you don't have that in the front of your head when you're thinking of that. But for sure, like, now that it's been proven, like, this was successful, like, in the second season, they can, like, even go further into the zaniness if they want. They can go deeper into the emotional stuff if they want. But, like, now that at least, like, this first season has, like, good proof of concept, so hopefully that opens up, like, creative freedoms for them wherever they are currently in production, right? And just speaking also to the idea of like, female-run adult animated shows, like, that is an even smaller list because, like, we have people like Rebecca Sugar and Noelle Stevenson running shows aimed at younger audiences. But, like, for example, I was looking up here Lisa Hanewalt on her Twitter a couple of days ago. It was, like, putting together a list of adult animated shows created by women, even including co-creation credits. And it's like it's hard to even get to 10. And, like, when you think about the giant amount of adult shows that have been made over the years, and for the proportion to be that small is just terrible. So hopefully this opens up the opportunities for more people in the future. Netflix has also recently given an order to one of the people who worked at Gravity Falls, Shion Takeuchi, I think that's pronounced. And I believe that's going to be an adult animated show as well. So hopefully that this continues forward and we get more great shows like Tuca and Bertie from a perspective that we don't usually get in these kind of shows. So yeah, Tuca and Bertie, great show. I think we're all thumbs in up. Agreement there. Yeah, two thumbs up. Talons up, or what?
They have fingers in the show.
They somehow have fingers.
Yeah. So, two bird thumbs up.
Two bird thumbs up. Yes.
Two bird thumbs up out of 10.
My thumbs are
out
birds.
Of 10.
It means 10 out of 10, maybe. Yeah. I don't know. Okay. Very close to 10 out of 10. I need more to judge.
All right, but yeah, hopefully we get to talk about the second season whenever it comes out. But until then, you can continue following us at overlyanimated.com, where we talk about a wide variety of animation here. You can chat with us about animation at overlyanimated.com/discord. We opened up a Tuca and Bertie specific channel, and we also have channels for a lot of the other shows we cover here. If you enjoyed this discussion and you're here up to now, then perhaps you would be willing to support us financially via Patreon. You can learn more about that at patreon.com/overlyanimated. Thanks to all of our current patrons, especially our patron of the podcast, Connie, aka Veronica Cucamonga. Thanks to our Patreon executive producers, Ryan, Steve, Beatrice, Hugh, and Michael. Besides this show, we've got Miraculous Ladybug coverage going on, Star vs. the Forces of Evil, DuckTales is coming back pretty soon. We've a lot of different kinds of shows that we talk about here for sure. We mentioned BoJack briefly. We did coverage on the most recent season, and we will talk about it again when that comes back.
Once in September, we spend time on BoJack.
Yeah, but hopefully May can be the May area can be the month of Tuca and Bertie.
Maybe
we'll get that. But until then, thanks for listening to us. I think we four have had a good, fun time, and we hope that you've had fun listening to us too. And we'll talk to you later. Goodbye.
Bye.
Please watch the show.
Bye.